So roughly this time of year, about 14 years ago, my wife and I briefly attended a Quaker meeting in San Antonio, Texas. And for those of you not familiar with the tradition, the Friends General Conference, which is the largest branch of Quakerism here in the United States, has a practice of worship that is completely silent. And it can remain silent for the entire hour or so that the Friends gather to meet. The only time anyone speaks is if an individual feels stirred by the Spirit of God to share something in the meeting. And there's no structure or hierarchy or prelude required. It's anyone is considered an equal in God's eyes and may stand up and share, but otherwise, it's sheer silence. Well, 14 years ago was rather significant because an individual who was sitting right here in the congregation and has given me permission to share this story was an infant, only a few months old at that time. Now, in our society, where the idea that silence and contemplation and the flow of adult life is something not to be interrupted by small children or infants, an infant in a silent worship meeting isn't the greatest fit. We laugh that it's a little too close to home. And of course, Lily got a little fussy after maybe 20 minutes or so of the silence. And so San Antonio being what it is, it was a bright sunny day in the middle of winter. And I took her out in the courtyard to walk her around in the store and see if she would calm down a bit. But a few minutes later, one of the elders came out. And it's fascinating to me that the first instinctive thought in my mind is, oh no, what did I do wrong? And the elder came to me with the gentlest expression on his face I can possibly imagine. He put an arm around my shoulder and gave an equally gentle look to Lily and said, I'd like to explain something to you about our tradition. He said, we never tell parents that if you're feeling uncomfortable, you shouldn't take your child out. You're welcome to do that. But from our point of view, a crying child is just another manifestation of the Holy Spirit trying to say something to us that we need to hear. So as far as we're concerned, you should feel completely welcome to leave our child in worship, even if she cries the entire hour. Now this was shocking to me. Wait, a church assembly? An adult assembly? A silent assembly that intentionally welcomes a fussy and crying child, and far from shrinking back, actually believes and teaches the notion that this is the Holy Spirit of God speaking to us in nonverbal, but nonetheless entirely poignant and necessary ways. Wow. Now, I'd like you all to just do an imaginative exercise for a moment. All of a sudden, the crying infant is right in front of you. Perhaps the crying infant is even your own child. And this is an infant too small to really do anything, completely pre-verbal, can't feed itself, probably can't even hold up its head. And that crying infant is right in front of you, maybe even in your arms. Just sit with that image for a moment. Now what are you feeling or wanting to do? Just pop up, just say it. Take them out, breastfeed.
Soothe the mama.
Okay. Is anybody feeling like, yeah, no big deal, I'm not motivated to do anything?
No.
Everybody is feeling like, I need to do something. I need to take care of someone or something here. That nurturing instinct, and I do mean instinct, is really at our primal core. I worry about the human being that doesn't feel it in some way, shape, or form, that doesn't react with like, I need to soothe this child, I need to feed this child, maybe at the very least I need to attend to the mother's needs. I need to do something to help in this situation. fact, we know for sure by Jewish tradition, only a few days old, not able to do anything, probably not even aware of his hands yet. You know that moment where babies suddenly discover their hands, like, oh, these things are mine. Not even yet at that stage. And they bring him into the temple. They're, of course, already doing what parents do and nurturing their baby infant. And these great aged prophets who have been waiting their entire life for this moment see Mary and Joseph with the infant and say, that's the one. And Simeon walks over and picks up the child and holds the child and says a sort of a blessing prayer and a farewell prayer for his own life in response to the experience of holding this infant in his arms. And then Anna likewise does something similar. What a bizarre scene, where if you really think about where is God in the scene, God is dwelling bodily in the most helpless person in the entire scene. Everybody else is nurturing God. Now, isn't that backwards? Isn't God always supposed to be in the higher power position? Isn't God always supposed to be the active one? The one who is nurturing us, feeding us, challenging us, motivating us, giving us breath? Now, all of that is absolutely true. That is most certainly God's role. But in this case, the tables get turned. We are the ones nurturing God. Mary is the one breastfeeding God. Joseph is the one protecting God. Simeon and Anna are the ones nurturing and loving God in that moment. Now, if God really is God, our understanding is transcendent, the uncreated creator who needs nothing. That must mean that God doesn't need to be nurtured by God's creatures. So there's only one other possible explanation for this bizarre scene, which is somehow we need the experience of being the nurturers. We need to be able to take care of God and be able to take care of God's creatures because it builds something in us that needs to be built. So friends, today on this Feast of the Presentation, I encourage you to see in the story, to see in the text, our deep need to nurture, and more specifically, to nurture the source from which we receive our being. There must be something in our need to be formed more and more into the image and likeness of God that is satisfied by the act of nurturing. Now, most of us, in fact, perhaps all of us, are never going to get to have the experience that Simeon and Anna had. We're never going to actually hold in our arms, at least in this lifetime, God in flesh. That is a likely thing. But we can hold God's creatures in our arms and nurture them anytime we like. There are 1,000 opportunities a day, and I dare say we tend to overlook and miss most of them. But think about Simeon and Anna. They were there praying night and day. They were awake to the possibility that I might actually get to nurture God. And when that opportunity came, they knew it, they pursued it, and they gave it their all. So the question that leaves us is, can we do the same? As we look out, we see a world that's got so many needs, so many problems, so many issues, and it is so tempting to detach ourselves from that one step. Yes, we'll work on them systemically, and don't get me wrong, we need to work on them systemically. Yes, we'll work on them a little bit in arm's reach, you know, we'll do the whole hospital thing and we'll treat you, but there's always sort of a machine or some physical barrier between us. But how often do we dare to drop all those barriers and really nurture? Really make close physical contact with some creature in this needy world of ours. I'm going to suggest that without that act, it's all incomplete. God is trying to form us more and more into creatures that are like the Creator, into students that are like the teacher, that are really, in most respects, equal with God. That's an incredibly high bar. And the act of nurturing is utterly essential in getting us to that goal. So friends, I invite you to be like Anna and Simeon. Pray without ceasing. Ask God to open your eyes to those opportunities to nurture God and the creation about you. And when they come, take it. It's not because God needs it.